An estimated 200 million women worldwide have endometriosis. And today we're going to be looking at a possible link between that chronic condition and diet. Hi, I am the weight loss champion, Chuck Carroll, and this is the Exam Room Podcast. My guest today is Dr. Hana Kahleova. She is the clinical director of research at the Physicians Committee. And I'm so glad that she is here with us today because, Dr. Kahleova, I understand that you are running a study right now that is really putting a hyper focus on endometriosis and a possible connection with what a woman is eating, correct?
That's exactly right, Chuck. Thank you so much for having me today. The link between nutrition and endometriosis is just fascinating. I brought some slides with me today, so let me share my screen. Endometriosis is a painful condition, and about 5 to 10% of women in the reproductive age suffer from this condition. The treatment options are fairly limited. We can try some pain medications, some hormonal therapy, but oftentimes these women require repeated surgeries. And so it's not uncommon that women in their 20s have had already a few surgeries with only limited success. And the pain and suffering is just beyond description. We know the hormonal roller coaster during the cycle. So we know that as the period comes closer, a lot of women struggle with discomfort and many of them struggle with severe pain. Women with endometriosis have a condition where the endometrium, which should be only in the uterus, that's the inner lining of uterus, is also located elsewhere, like in the fallopian tubes and in the ovaries and in the pelvis and, you know, around the abdomen. And this causes inflammation and pain. Sometimes it's associated with heavy periods, but also other symptoms like indigestion and diarrhea. Oftentimes, it's associated with infertility as well. So what's the way out? Is there any link between nutrition and endometriosis? One study was looking at meat consumption and the estrogen levels in women. And the researchers compared women who were semi-vegetarian. That means that they didn't eat any red meat and they were consuming only small amount, less than 20 grams per day of fish or white meat per day, to women who were omnivorous or non-vegetarian, who were consuming as much meat as they wanted, including red meat. And the study found that the estrogen levels were much lower in semi-vegetarians. This is estrone. Semi-vegetarians have lower levels compared to omnivorous women. And the same for estradiol levels. Semi-vegetarians have lower levels compared to non-vegetarian women. For women who think, well, okay, I can live without red meat, I'll just eat more donuts, I have some bad news. Another study found out that trans saturated fat, which is the fat that's oftentimes used in sweets such as donuts or other treats, although due to regulations, the trans fats should not be as prevalent as they used to be. Trans fat is also associated with a higher risk of endometriosis. On the bright side, if you eat a lot of fruit, fruit fiber decreases the risk of endometriosis by 11%, and the fiber contained in grains, cereal fiber, reduces the risk of endometriosis by 10%. So there seem to be some clear links between nutrition and endometriosis. But you may be wondering, okay, so how exactly do I put all these pieces together? Like if I, let's say, skip meat, if I don't eat donuts, if I eat a lot of fruit and a lot of cereal or a lot of grains, is that enough? Well, the answer is, you know, we cannot put these pieces together just yet, because there's a few pieces missing. And that's exactly why we're recruiting for a study right now, and you can be a part of it. We'd like to bring more light into this topic. So check out our website at pcrm.org/endometriosis or endoresearch.org. The study that we're conducting is comparing a usual diet with a low-fat vegan diet that consists of fruits and vegetables and grains and legumes for 12 weeks. And what can you expect if you participate in the study? You will get weekly meetings over Zoom, one-on-one meetings with our dietitians, and also lab work at baseline and at week 12. How do you find out if you qualify? You need to have a verified diagnosis of endometriosis. You need to be at the age of between 18 and 45. And you need to be from the DC area in order to come in for the labs. So we're recruiting right now. Check out our website, pcrm.org/endometriosis or endoresearch.org. This is our study flyer. And please sign up and contribute to science, because you can be helped, but you can also help other women with endometriosis. Your experience is invaluable, and you can be a part of something bigger that can help many women worldwide.
I will tell you, Dr. Kahleova, that from my time here on the show, that I have spoken to a number of women who have had endometriosis, and they have just told me about the horrors of the pain that they went through. Yeah. And it just dragged on, you know, every month for years they would have this horrific period where, I mean, it just disrupted their quality of life. You know, it affected their personal life, their professional life. Like, one woman used up all of her sick days very rapidly because of this. She just literally could not make it to court for trial. And she was an attorney, you know, very, very problematic there. But the cool thing about this show too is, again, anecdotally, admittedly, we need more research on this. These women also, by shifting toward a more plant-forward diet or an entirely plant-based diet, were able to, in a lot of cases, reverse their endometriosis. You know, we have Catherine Lawrence Ireland, Dr. Kahleova is one famous example, who was a macaroni and cheese junkie. I mean, she went through blue boxes like most people change their socks. And she goes in for a surgery the day of the surgery. And the doctor's like, he just closes her back up. He says, I can't perform it. I mean, it's just gone. And that was because not too terribly long earlier, she had adopted a plant-based diet. And we've heard that time and time and time again. You know, Jessica Murnane, another famed example. She wrote the book, Know Your Endo. And so I think that, you know, you have these little stories here and there. And so I love the fact that you're recruiting for this research so that, yeah, we can get something published that would definitively say diet can play a huge role in this. So I guess my question to you, my long-winded question to you, is why do you think it's taken so long for somebody to take a look at the connection between the two?
That's a great question, Chuck. We've relied, generally speaking, we've relied on the conventional treatment options. There's hormonal therapy, there's painkillers, there's surgery, but at the same time, we see how limited their ability to help these women is. And that's exactly where nutrition comes in play. Sometimes it's kind of sad to see that nutrition is kind of the afterthought instead of being upfront. But I'm glad we're coming to this point now when we're realizing that in order to help these women, we just need to step up and just research all the all the lifestyle factors, including nutrition, that plays a central part.
All right. And if somebody is watching this a little bit later than when we released it, say, you know, a month or two from now, how long is the recruiting window open?
So we're recruiting until the end of April. But we're planning also future applications. So if you're watching and it's already, past the recruitment, don't worry, you can still apply for the second round.
Okay. And what if somebody were to go through this and successfully pass the screening process, what can they expect? I mean, are they going to be provided menus to follow? Are you going to be providing the meals? How big of a time commitment are we looking at? And can you flesh some of that out for us?
Absolutely. The study takes 12 weeks, and the women who qualify will be randomly assigned either to the control group that will stay on their usual diet or to the intervention group that will be changing their diet into a low-fat vegan diet. The time commitment is weekly Zoom meetings that take an hour, so it's an hour a week. A meeting with a dietitian and just changing their overall lifestyle, getting some recipes, getting the labs at baseline and after 12 weeks. That's for all women. And some women may also feel, well, I would only do it if I'm in the vegan group. But in order to perform the study and conduct it in a good way, we need it to be a randomized controlled trial. And the control group plays an important role too. And the women in the control group will also get the diet at the end of the 12 weeks. So no matter which group you will be in, we will tell you how to do this kind of dietary intervention.
Fantastic. And I really do hope that that you get some really good, solid data out there that can be published and open up a lot of eyes to the medical community that we should be looking more closely at diet in addition to traditional medicine right now. So the links to apply for the study right now are in the show notes or in the episode description. So go ahead and click on those, pcrm.org/endometriosis or endoresearch.org. Both send you to the same place where you can apply right there online pretty easily. Again, it is in the show description or in the episode notes. And Dr. Kahleova, thank you so very much for taking the time today and best of luck with the research.
Thanks for having me, Chuck.
If your health IQ is a couple of points higher than it was a few minutes ago, go ahead and like this video or subscribe to the YouTube channel. And to take it even higher, head over to Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your favorite shows. Look for the Exam Room by the Physicians Committee. Hit the subscribe button there as well and help to make your world a healthier place.